Good morning. It's July 1st, 2015. It's 10:02, and we will open up the County Commission meeting. Call to order, Mr. Eldon Callan.
Here.
Mr. Ed Hawkins.
Here.
And Tom Bloom is here. At this time, I ask for you to rise for a moment of silent meditation and pledge to the flag. I'd also like to keep your thoughts and prayers in for Ed's mom and a safe recovery. Thank you.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
You're quite welcome.
Consent and approvals.
There are no exonerations today.
Good.
Fiduciary orders as of July 1, minutes of June 17. General County vouchers, $379,725.15. Coal Severance Fund, $11,826.96. Camp Muffley, $17,735.93. Chestnut Ridge Park, $1,525. Mason Dixon Park, $593.75. Assessor's Valuation Fund, $1530. Teen Court, $11,053.26. 911 cash, $1,574.49. Law Enforcement Forfeiture, $2,000. For a total of $426,049.84. I have budget revisions end of year for County Commission, Circuit Clerk, and Assessor.
And how's prerogative of this commission?
Move to approve.
Second.
Been properly moved and second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. It passes. At this time, we are at 10:04. We will have comments from the public. If anyone would like to stand up and speak, please state your name, address, and you can talk about whatever you'd like. Public portion is open. And we have thousands that are waiting in line, but I guess they're gonna wait till after the holiday. So I see no one, so the public portion is closed. At this time, we will have Renetta McClure with grants. Okay, we will hold off for a second and hope that everyone has a safe July 4th. And hope that everyone goes down to the Celebration of America that I know Eldon is strongly involved with and different programs that will be going on. And out of the blue, here we go. Here's Renetta.
Right.
Dun, 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 dun. I had a good time in Vegas.
Okay, we have a couple requests for reimbursement and then some other miscellaneous items.
Okay.
The first one is a Governor's Community Participation Grant for WVU Center for Excellence in Disabilities. It covers April 13, 15 through May 31st,
2015.
$2,784.78.
Okay.
Sorry. Okay. And then we have the Emergency Solutions Grant Program for the month of June, $5,870.38. That's the reimbursements that I have today.
Move to approve the reimbursement.
Second.
Been properly moved and second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
It passes.
Okay, we have the Community Development Block Grant contract for the HUD grant that runs through the city of Morgantown for MAYSP. This covers fiscal year 2016. They were awarded the amount of $11,933 for the year. And we'll be working with MAYSP on that. So this is just the contract for us.
Move to approve.
Second.
Been properly moved and second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Okay. I think I'll wait. I'll wait for that one. We're getting ready to have a public hearing for this JAG application.
Okay.
So I'll wait.
Hold off for
this,
that.
Yes, until
okay.
After the public hearing.
Okay.
As you know, we applied a few weeks ago for the Waste Coal Producing Counties Grant Program. Received word on Thursday morning or Thursday afternoon that there's two pieces that they're waiting on from us that they need before they can send the final approval. So I just have a few items to present to you today. The first is a resolution. And then we also have a certificate of project completion for the 2012 award, which we had applied for a Fairview Water Project, and then a progress report on the federal building renovations. Those were the two projects that we applied for before. So we have a certificate of project completion because the Fairview Water Extension Project was completed in July of 2014. So we have that. And then we have a certificate of progress for the federal building renovations, which is not complete yet, but will be shortly. So we also have the project report.
Move to approve the president signing those two documents.
Okay. Second. It's been properly moved and second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you very much.
Okay. We also have a resolution. Would you like me to read?
Please.
Sure.
Okay.
Please.
Be it resolved that the Monongalia County Commission, in a regular meeting held on May 27, 2015, gave authorization to the Honorable Thomas C. Bloom, President of the Monongalia County Commission, to act on its behalf by signing the application for the West Virginia Development Office in order to receive and administer grant funds pursuant to the provisions of the Waste Coal Producing Counties Grant. Funds in the amount of $296,463.61 were requested by the Monongalia County Commission for the following projects: $266,817.25 for renovations to the Courthouse Square project, and $29,646.36 for the reopening of the Upper Monongahela River Locks. And the county clerk has to sign the resolution.
Move to approve the resolution. Right.
Second.
And properly moved and second. I do want to say, does anyone want to talk about, since, you know, Eldon, you were pushing about the locks and we're putting the money there, and also...
Yeah, I was going to save those comments until Barry gets up here.
Okay, yes. So is there anything you would like to say? I just want to say that, again, this is a congratulations to our administrative staff who worked very quickly on this, and not only is it the grant, but it's not going to be any taxpayer dollars to fix the courthouse square, which is a $266,000 grant that we are very excited about. So with that, call for the question. The question's been called, so now we'll have a vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye, sorry. It passes. So excited. And whenever people want to give us money, that real excited about that. Okay, fantastic. At this time, if we don't mind, I see Barry Pillay in the audience. Do you want to stand up and talk to him? Come on down here so you can. Are you with anyone?
And I have my vice president, Frank Janasek.
Frank, please. Come on down.
Frank has served 46 years with DNR and is now the vice president of UMRA. So we're pleased to have Frank. Let me say we were awarded by General Bostic, the commanding general of the Army Corps of Engineers, an award, and it reads Commander's Award for Public Service. Now, this is an award that we all earned. And let me say that the County Commission has been critical in this work. This is a public-private partnership. That is UMRA and the Mon County Commission and the Army Corps of Engineers. And what this is it's a coalition of all the communities, of all the cities between Star City and Morgantown and Fairmont and all the counties. Without the County Commission being the legal entity, we couldn't have put this coalition together. Okay? And Eldon is a heart of it, has spoken eloquently over many years. We've negotiated with the Corps for 2 years. And UMRA has been at this since 2002, so it's about 13 years. So in any event, this is a recognition, and I think you all should take a picture.
Well, sure, come up here. Five of us take a picture. It would be great.
Yeah. I think we all should be in this.
Yes, no, I agree.
And Tom, hold that there,
How's that?
His new job. We'll just add it on his list.
Thank you.
And I know both Ed and Eldon want to say something. Thank you.
Hold on to that for a moment.
Yes.
All right. I appreciate that.
And let me emphasize how much work Barry has done on this, because you all know what it's like to deal with government entities, and the Corps of Engineers is probably the epitome of complications. And so if you would have told me 2 years ago that this could have been achieved, even though I've dealt with the Corps for my whole career, I would have said it's really unlikely. So he has kept everybody's feet to the fire. You all have really made it easy because you've been so cooperative. You know, and that gives us more power when we're dealing with an agency like that. So thanks.
Thank you.
We thank you. It was 2011. Barry stopped me at Kroger's. I'd just been 3 months in office, and after about 45 minutes, I was sold on UMRA and its mission. And I've tried to attend as much as I could and been there often. I couldn't help after that discussion to just travel the river, both on the trail and by car. And from
and
here to
boat.
Pittsburgh, and then by boat. I'll never forget the first colonel that was up at the Corps of Engineers, and we had a meeting out at the engineering building.
Filled the auditorium.
Right, yeah. Filled the auditorium, and I got up and spoke about George Washington and Albert Gallatin.
Yes.
And they were taken aback. But I had the facts and the figures and when they built, I don't remember it right now, but I've got it in my file someplace. When they built the private building, where they built it, why they built it, and the fact that there was nothing here. And it was a vision of Albert Gallatin, and he recruited George Washington, that this area, the whole watershed of the upper Monongahela River.
And the river could be an economic engine.
That it would be the economic engine to make it possible for settlers and industry to thrive here. We're now here because of their vision. That sort of put the colonel, took the colonel back, I think. He was like...
Eldon actually said in a follow-up meeting after that, he said, we will do whatever needs to be done, to reopen the locks. And that's exactly what you've done.
Well, thank you. And the support of the commission has made this possible. It's just really thrilling because, as Frank said, after that meeting and Butch Tennant, commissioner from Marion County, was there. I looked at Butch and I said, before I said it openly, I said, Butch, these locks are in Montague County, so Montague County should do it. Do you agree? He said, yeah, go for it. And I said, that's when I announced to the group that Montague County will do it. And like you said, do whatever is necessary to make this happen. So I thank you all for your efforts, and it's just the beginning as far as I'm concerned, and thank the commission for their support and backing. Thank you very much.
Eldon knows this is a model that could be replicated across the country. There are probably maybe 70 locks now that are closed mm-hmm. across the country. The last one was Minneapolis,
right.
Closed permanently, never to reopen again. So this is really very important. We've got them open again, and that we're a model for the rest of the country. They can replicate this in 70 communities.
Well, even the colonel at the time, as Frank said, when I went up and talked to him after, he referred me to one or two people down his list that worked for him. Even they sort of said, well, this has never been done before. I don't really think this is going to happen.
Right.
And I said, send me the paperwork anyway. We're going to try.
Eldon, could you take a picture with Diane? Because Diane has been really...
She's been very critical.
Yeah, been critical. We wouldn't have all the dollars put together. Every community from Fairmont to here has contributed, and Diane has kept track of the dollars. It's critical.
And the quick responses are really important when you're dealing with these agencies.
You got one more, Bobby?
Yeah, let me get that.
Okay. Oh, my hair's up.
Do that. I don't have a problem.
That was coming back. That was a knife flight from Vegas.
Somebody do
this. There we go.
I'll tell you, with Diane and the picture, it's a much better picture.
Yes.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you very much.
I would like to say, to commend them both, because I've followed this project at least from afar. I remember being on a boat trip with Frank, I believe, in 2008.
And on the water locks.
Yes. And yes, but it's really a great day and a great thing that you've achieved. Commending you both. Glad Frank has a new job.
One last thing, and that is the next chapter. Now that we've reopened the locks, the most important chapter is to regrow commerce and recreation. So right. That's the tough part. And that's what we're beginning.
If you build it, they will come.
That's right.
And you use the two words, the coalition and partnership, which the three county commissioners are trying to do. And when you said economic development, it was perfect timing. This grant, we decided to invest in you, and that's where $29,000 is going to go in that investment to continue and move this forward. And we thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Oh, okay.
Be quick.
You?
I know the torque.
You're not as quick as you.
Oh, thank you.
Gentlemen, what we have today is we have James Haynes, who is transferring. This is an internal transfer from a part-time position in transport process to a full-time position. We had a full-time employee leave to take employment with WVU, and James has transferred. He's been with us for a while now, and does an excellent job. And we would want to start him at a monthly salary of $2,703 effective July 1. And of course, being a full-time position, he would be eligible for full benefits, and there would be a six-month probationary period since he's transferring to full-time status.
Move to approve.
Second.
Been properly moved and second to support James Haynes in the new position. All those in favor say aye.
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 It passes.
Are you any relation to the Haynes's that make those automobile magazines and stuff?
I have no clue.
Man,
I'm not sure.
I was going to say, you might have some money there for your family.
If you want, you might want to find
out. Well, the good thing is you'll be going into the new building. You'll be moving into the new building, too, and when you have to transfer people to the courtroom. So.
You'll be happy.
Yes.
Okay. Welcome aboard. Nice to have you. Well, I guess you're welcome aboard full-time, I should say. You've been on the board, yeah.
It is 10:20. Have the public hearing for the JAB grant. If there's anyone wishing to speak, please state your name, stand up, and explain whether you're supportive or you're not supportive.
You might want to tell them what JAB is.
It's actually not JAB, it's JAG.
Yeah,
JAB.
I thought.
Assistant grant, yeah. This is a grant that we applied.
Yeah, that's a typo.
This is a grant we applied for the Sheriff's Department.
Oh, that's
Department
right.
Department of Justice grant. $17,464, and the sheriff may want to speak about it, but we're going to, we have applied for funding for a 2015 Harley-Davidson Police FLHP Road King motorcycle. And Sheriff, you want to say a few words, since it's for you?
Sure.
Yeah. Motorcycle gloves.
Very quickly, as you all may remember, Governor's Highway Safety Program gave us a Can-Am Spyder at no cost. And
I never did get to drive that thing.
We still have it, so whenever you're ready, we got a helmet that'll fit. we've had some problems with that motorcycle over the period of time that we've had it. We've had clutch problems, we've had engine problems, we've had some leaks that had to be fixed, and we've put some money into it. Even though it didn't cost us anything, and we've had to put some money into it. We've talked to other agencies that have those Can-Am Spyders, and what we found was that those agencies are having trouble with them too. I don't know if you remember or not, but Morgantown Police had one of them given to them as well that burned up on Willie Street. The engine caught on fire and burned up. So
we have a need for the motorcycles, and we have uses for them, and we use them all the time in highway safety programs. We use them in parades. We use them in special traffic enforcement and things like that. So we thought, since we have this grant, this would be a perfect opportunity where it wouldn't cost the county any money, that we could buy this motorcycle through the grant. We did get, as you remember last week, I showed you the certificate from the governor's office on the highway safety award that we got. Mm-hmm. Along with that award, we got a $2,000 certificate where we could buy highway safety things for our department. So what we planned on doing was the balance that's left over from the $17,000 grant, we were going to use to decal and outfit the motorcycle, and then we'll put that $2,000 certificate towards that also. So it won't cost the county anything. Good. Other than insurance coverage and
right.
upkeep.
Right, normal. Yeah. Now, what are you going to do with the other one?
The other one, we asked Highway Safety if they wanted it back, and they said, just hang on to it for a while, and we'll see what we want to do with it. Because
I just wondered if they knew that they had those problems before they gave it to us.
I don't think they did, because they were relatively new when we got these. They bought 25, I think, at one time, and then distributed them throughout the state. I don't think that they realized the problems they were having with them at the time. That's why when the state bid on police cruisers went to the Ford Taurus all-wheel drives, we waited for a couple of years to see what kind of problems they had with them before we bought any, and they've been good cars. But that's kind of what we did. Now, Harley-Davidson obviously has a wonderful reputation. It's a great motorcycle. They make a great product. We have a local vendor, which is Triple S Harley, is where we're going to buy it from. So service and everything can be here. On the K&M, we've had to take the K&M to Buchanan every time we need a service on it. So it's a pain to get it there, get it back, and everything. But this will be, I think it'll be a good purchase. And again, other than insurance coverage and the upkeep, it won't cost us anything.
With that clarification for the JAG grant, is there anyone willing to speak on this issue? Seeing none,
close the public hearing.
I'll close the public hearing now. Did you want to have us approve, or do you need to read?
Well, the application's already been submitted, okay. Pending this public hearing.
Oh, okay.
So I just have to send certification that it's been.
We had the
public hearing. We don't have to take any further action.
No, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Okay. We will hold off on the executive session. Correspondence, Department of Highways upcoming project for public comment. Did you want to explain?
This is just a letter that they send in their planned projects.
I saw the two of them.
There's only two from Mon County, and it's just, this is being circulated for public comment, so we'll have it available up front.
Yeah. Beechhurst Avenue resurfacing, which I saw they started to, they looks like they finished
the
sidewalks.
Curb cuts.
And hopefully we'll be able to start doing that. The other, I just want people to know, and this is the state, this isn't us, Morgantown bicycle signage, $120,000. Okay.
Just for your information.
So that's now for public information.
That the letter's going to be available for people to submit
yes.
comments.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It'd be good to the newspaper publish that.
Yes.
So anyone want to come make comments?
And you can have my I'll give this to the newspaper. You can. Okay, a letter from Sam Chico, willing to continue on Board of Health.
I'd move that we appoint Sam Chico to another term with the Board of Health.
Second.
Been proper moved and second. I know he was interviewed last week,
yes.
So following the procedure. Is there anything else you want to?
June 30, 2020 will be the end of his next term.
Okay, great. It's been proper moved and second. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay, Mr. Chico. Is there any other correspondence?
That his letter was just saying that he'd like to continue.
He would like to do it. Okay, that's it. Fantastic. Okay, unfinished business. Health insurance increase.
We had planned on and did receive a 3% increase for the health insurance. So
okay.
The commission had talked in work session about what to do with that. I think you kind of thought you would not pass it on to the employee for
right.
individual coverage, but you would pass it on to the family coverage. So you need to make a motion that be.
Yeah, I'm gonna make a motion that we cover the 3% increase on the employees, not increasing any employees' insurance contribution. However, for family coverage, that increase will be bear by borne by the individual.
Second.
Been properly moved in second to cover the 3% individual health insurance. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Passes. Glad we're able to do that. It's a minor benefit, but I think turns into major.
Yes. Well, we've got to take care of our employees.
Yeah. Is there any other unfinished business? One thing I'd like to bring up under unfinished business. We had talked about last year, we had set like mid-June as a deadline for purchases for this fiscal year and then start the next year. One of the concerns that I know we have is in monitoring and accountability. I know there's a number of, departments that might be charging things for these next 2 weeks and putting it on the old fiscal year. I'd be interested with the others to somehow just not, I'm not talking about the regular purchases that need to be done, but I'd be just interested in seeing if these next 2 weeks, if people are, you know, at the end of the year, well, you know what I'm saying?
If I may.
Yeah, go right ahead.
I would like to first ask Carrie how the process works at the end of the year.
Sure.
And then we can determine from that what we want to ask for.
Well, anything that has an invoice date of June 30th or before is processed off of fiscal year 15 budget. Anything that comes through with a July 1 or after date is processed off fiscal year 16. So you could have purchases, what you want to make sure you're not looking at is just because someone got an invoice June the 25th does not mean that they just started making that purchase June the 25th. They could have been in process of making a purchase and just got the invoice for it at the end of the month.
Mm-hmm.
You know, many of these departments start in March looking at purchases that they want to make, taking into account where they stand with their budget. And they may start looking at those kind of things in March and just now got the invoice for it. But if we get something through that has an invoice date of June 30th or before, we process it off of fiscal year 15. So we usually wrap up all of our purchases for the previous budget year sometime in the middle of July.
Okay.
Because usually, I mean, we may not get a June 30th invoice until July 10th or July 12th.
Okay, I know we have talked about, you know, trying to head it off June 15th, you know, and making recommendations. I just want to make sure if we can monitor it and so, you know, the departments know that we are watching and making sure. I mean, I'm not saying that any department's doing anything wrong, but it's just something that we want to keep monitoring because, you know, at the end of the year, fiscal year, we just want to make sure that we have everything financially sound.
Yeah.
Okay.
Have everything financially sound because you get monthly reports of where every budget stands.
Right.
And each department gets a monthly report of where they stand at the end of the month, so they know what they have expended, what they have still yet to expend before the end of the fiscal year. Most of your departments are very frugal with their money.
Right.
You can tell that by the percentage of the budget that they have used. So.
Okay.
Yeah. That's what I was going to say, that there are reports, and actually you could go down and review the department numbers if you want to look at the more specifics of things.
Okay.
Those are already completed. That's
okay.
I think that would probably be the best way.
Yeah, so what I'll do is I will look at the departments and just get an idea in the monthly statements. I think that will have a better idea for me to start with.
I believe, Diane, do you get a full list every month, do you not?
Of the
departments?
Department district.
I usually get only nine, unless I ask for a full printout.
Okay. Well, we can get you a full printout.
Could you get us a full? I think we just like to have it, so that would be
understood. That's what I was saying.
That would be great. Okay. Then that's all I would need. Okay.
We never ask for a complete.
Yeah, we've never done it before. I just want to take a look at it. So.
Yeah, that's not a problem.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, new business. consideration of appointments to the Board of Health. Oh. Well, we just took care of that. There wasn't anyone else.
That was on page two. I hadn't read it yet.
And perfect time since we're talking consideration of new voting equipment. Did you want to explain?
Yes.
And how long and old the...
Speaking of spending money, do
we yes.
Yeah, I got a copy for them also.
Okay. She went over with everything right. with us in work session last week.
Thank you.
Thank you.
As you know, I've been working on purchasing some electronic poll books for use in our precincts. You all should be familiar with those. That's the device that we use to check in the voter when they first come into a polling precinct. We've used them in early voting for a number of years, and we've been talking for the last couple of years about expanding that into our precincts for Election Day. We piloted 10 precincts this last election. They worked very well, so we moved forward with that purchase for last fiscal year. So, Commissioner Bloom, when you get that invoice, don't
say
but anyway.
Remember the zero on
yes.
that, though?
Yes.
Pardon?
Remember the zero on that?
Yes.
The zero.
Right. The worker, the...
Zero had, compared to an L.
She spelled yeah. my name ELD0N
yeah.
and kept saying I wasn't registered, and she finally figured it out. But
yeah.
I thought that was cute to how easy things could get off track.
Well, but what I take from that is how accurately those machines reflect what you put into them.
Oh yes,
right.
Oh yeah, and that's a positive.
They won't let them pick up something that they didn't actually ask for.
Right,
so.
Right, right. Yeah, I thought it was a positive.
Yeah, but what I have before you today for your consideration is, we are currently using Ivotronic touchscreen voting machines.
Right.
And there is a new generation of election equipment that has been developed and is available for us to use. The new election equipment is called Express Vote, and it's still made by the same manufacturer, Election Systems and Software. What I've given there for you to look at today is sort of the schematic of what the machine actually looks like. You're familiar with what we're using today, the touchscreen mm-hmm. machine that sits on a stand printer booth, has a paper roll that I generally call like a cash register receipt that is our paper trail. This new generation of machine actually combines removes the cash register receipt or the paper roll, and it provides the voter with an actual ballot that they are given when they walk into the poll after they have registered and check in. It's a completely blank sheet of paper, specially formulated to be marked with this Express Vote machine. The piece of paper goes into the machine. They use the Ivotronic or the touchscreen is mainly an electronic pencil or pen, if you will. They make their selections. When they're done with their selections, they hit print, and it prints out, brings them back out their ballot so that they can visually see and hold in their hand a ballot with all of the selections that they made. They don't have to look in that little screen anymore.
Right.
Then before they leave the polling location, they take that ballot and they put it into a scanner, and that drops into a ballot box.
Gotcha.
And that scanner is what's keeping track then of the actual ballots that are cast. So if someone walks in and they mark a ballot and they get it back and they look at it and they say, I didn't want to vote for that person, they can spoil that ballot, get another one, and keep doing that. They only put one in the scanner one time.
Gotcha.
But I think that what this new, we've been looking, keeping on top of the new equipment that has come out, and there really hasn't been that much advancement in election equipment, especially at the federal level. But they have developed this new equipment, which I think brings the best of both worlds together. You're still getting a paper ballot. People still like to hold that paper ballot in their hand. And even though they won't be able to hand write it or hand mark it, they'll use the machine to mark it, but they'll still be able to get it back, hold it in their hand, and have the confidence in being able to read just exactly who they voted for before they put that into the scanner. So for your consideration, the packet there that I have given you is what the machine actually looks like. It does have a smaller footprint than what we're using now, and by that I mean, you know, what we're using now is on a stand.
Right.
It has to be standing up. These machines are designed that they can be carried and are a lot more portable because, again, they're just an electronic pen is what I call them.
Right.
They don't have anything else involved with them. They can be sat on a table or they can be used on the booths. I have pictures there that show mm-hmm. you what they look like on the carts that we are hopeful that we can also access so that we can deliver these to our polling locations already on those carts, and it'll just be a very easy process for us.
And what happens to the old voting machines? Is that like a trade-in value?
Yes.
Okay.
We don't want to publish that too much because we'll okay. sell them real quick.
Yeah. Part of what I have before you in the proposal for your consideration, they did make arrangements or did give us a trade-in allowance for the machines that we actually have. So we are saving some money there.
Good.
One of the reasons I wanted to bring this to your consideration early, we would be the first county in the state to use this equipment for 2016. The advantage to that is other counties are still using the same equipment that we are currently right. using. We have a lot of peripheral material and okay. supplies that go along with that, and an advantage to us yeah. in making this move early is that we would be able to unload, hopefully,
yes.
These supplies that we have on hand.
I think that's a good idea.
Also, for your consideration to note, I was able to negotiate with the vendor. They're going to give it to us at 0% interest for 5 years, mm-hmm. and which is a pretty good deal
yeah.
for the amount that we're speaking of on this contract. So I'll open it up for any questions if you have.
Well, not questions so much comment. I think this is an excellent machine. I know that I think it addresses concerns that people had for Ivotronics, and I know it had the little sheet down there, but no one ever looked at that little receipt down there, and I know so many people, especially the older people, that were sure that when they pushed that button, it was not going to vote for who they said it would. That confidence of having that physically in your hand, I think is tremendous and a great asset to our people. And I commend you for finding this equipment, and I would move that we approve the purchase.
I'm very excited to second that and also wish to commend you on your hard work. This is very good for the county. I like to be a leader in technology.
Yes. It's been properly moved and second. My only question is, when we talk about accountability for the commission and you all, I wonder if we could be accountable for the citizens can now be accountable and we'll have a larger turnout, mm-hmm. which would be nice. So now people want accountability. I think it would be great for them now mm-hmm. to say that, you know.
Well, they won't have the excuse, well, I want to have paper. They'll have paper.
That's right. No, I think it's a great idea. I think it's yes. it combines both, and I think it's great. It's been properly moved and second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
It passes.
I just have one more comment. Thank you very much for that and for your comments. One other advantage to these machines will be a canvassing. You know, one of the
yes.
difficult things
that was tough.
To canvas
that's what I was, yes.
is reading
that
those paper rolls. Now all we will need to do, we'll have the ballots, and the only thing marked on that ballot is actually who was voted for.
Right, you wouldn't
so,
have the name.
Yeah, it should make our canvassing procedure go a lot smoother, and I think that it will be cheaper for us in the long run, not that the word cheap and elections go hand in the same sentence, because they're very expensive propositions, but there's not as much material required to handle an election with this equipment as there is with the equipment that we were previously using. So I'm hoping that even though this is an extreme expenditure of money, that in the long run we're going to see some financial savings as we hold these elections into the future. Thank you.
One quick question. I just thought, where do we store the machine? Do we still have that space over at the old mall? Will we need that space if, or is that space?
Well, we still need the space.
Is that not,
okay. Till we come up with something else. But the storage is different.
Storage will be different. Okay.
Yes. I'm trying to reduce our overall footprint.
Right, I understand.
Where we're going to have to store these in off election years.
Okay.
We are committed to the mall through the end of calendar year 2016.
Okay.
We did that last year so that we could get through all of our federal building transitions and all those kind of things. So we're fine right now, but it will be. We will have to have a place to store these. We're a large county, and we just have a considerable number of them that we have to. But our overall footprint should be somewhat less because of this new equipment.
That's what I thought, which is another savings again.
Yes, hopefully. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for your help. Is there any other new business?
I have a resolution. This is last week we talked about this Route 2 I-68.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes.
Do you want to,
You read it. They like your voice better.
Resolution. Whereas the continued economic growth of Monongalia County is vital to the interest of its people, businesses, and communities. Whereas four-lane highways have proven to stimulate and expand economic activity for those regions where highways have been completed. And whereas said upgrade of Route 2 is under construction with other portions being shovel-ready. And whereas I-68 is complete to Morgantown, West Virginia, with expectations of it reaching to the Ohio River. And whereas the expansion of I-68 to the west will provide a valuable tool to increase the economic development across the north central area of West Virginia. And whereas a completed I-68 would provide direct access to the Port of Baltimore. And whereas a completed I-68 would provide an important function to the Homeland Security Department as an emergency route from the nation's capital and surrounding metropolitan areas in the case of national emergency. Whereas the completion of the Route 2 upgrade and extension of I-68 is recognized by multiple regional economic development authorities, partnerships, and councils as being a most important stimulus project for the area. Whereas an expanded Route 2 and I-68 will divert dangerous traffic from two-lane roads. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Monongalia County Commission does hereby support and urge representatives of our state and federal government to do everything in their power to secure funding for the completion of the Route 2 expansion and extension of I-68 westward to the Ohio Valley.
Move to approve the resolution as read.
Second.
It's been properly moved and second. All those in favor to pass the resolution say aye.
Aye.
Aye. It passes. Okay.
And the sheriff has a new employee for the tax office.
I don't know about this person.
Do you know her?
A captain of my tennis team for, yes.
No.
Lexi, I'm sorry.
Me too.
Just a couple of years ago. That's it.
She was the captain of your tennis team?
Oh, yeah, excellent. And made it to the States, yes.
I'll tell you what, that's
very good. Yes.
I'm even more impressed with you now. You still playing tennis?
A little bit.
Well, after you're captain of his team, what's there left but down?
Yeah.
All right, gentlemen, who we'd like to introduce today is obviously Commissioner Bloom, already knows her, Alexis Cunningham. We have hired her for a full-time position in the tax office. She has gone through all the background checks required, financial and criminal background, and luckily for her, she's young enough she didn't have either, so that's good. But we had a starting date of her, which was yesterday, and she would have a probation period of 6 months. She's eligible for full benefits, and her monthly salary would be $2,375.
Move to approve.
Second. Been properly moved and second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, welcome to the team and another kind of team.
No relation to Robert Cunningham out of the Storstown Road?
None.
Okay. I just wondered, I grew up with him.
Yeah. Not the Cunninghams around here. I'm from New Jersey originally. So.
From where?
New Jersey.
That's where
see, you followed him down there.
See, I recruited. See, now they found out I recruited.
You go out.
But no, Lexi was one of the first of a long range of, you know, we had not had people make the state tournament. And Lexi worked really hard and was a captain and made it. And then after that, we just continued real well and would hope that tennis would continue to grow in this county.
But yeah, get on that.
I know. I know, I'll try. But
welcome that, aboard.
Yeah, you got a great individual and a great person too.
Good. Now that's good to hear. So everybody in her background check, I mean, there was absolutely, and this is the part that scares me because we always like to dig for somebody that's got something bad to say. Nobody had anything bad to say about
it. You mean that on that criminal thing it didn't say friends with Tom Bloom?
Yeah. And you would have thought that would have
been set a red flag at the FBI investigating.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, any reports from elected officials? You're here?
Yeah.
All right.
Just a little one. We're happy to report that we are moving forward with online filing this year. I think actually rollout is today, so you all please be patient with us. It's in direct response to some things that were going on in the state, and mostly to what we were encountering from taxpayers when we were in the community. So for personal property filing of your assessment this year, you can now do that online.
Wow.
And we're hoping that everything goes real smooth, so keep your fingers crossed.
So that's for the July 1st?
Yes.
File? Oh, that's great.
Okay, is there anyone else? Okay. Reports from County Commission. Ed, you want to go first?
I'll give the report I gave last week, Tom.
Sure.
It was, tonight is Solid Waste Authority meeting, so I have been still meeting with them. But I asked Mr. Giambroni if he could arrange for a meeting with me of the Marion County Solid Waste Authority, at least a couple members, and he did so. It was fortuitous in the day that I met them. They had their full meeting that night. Mm-hmm. So I went to their meeting and I had a suggestion that I would like them to consider. And it is regarding our recycling. That's why we decided to wait until you were here before taking any action, if we take action. My suggestion was that they consider putting the containers that they used before, but put them in a centralized location, in that I feel that Monongalia County would, if let's say there were 20 or 25 sort containers in a place close to the interstate, let's just say, for example, Saberton, the property there that the Southern States is on, if they would permit, or Easton School, they click down the interstate, that I feel the citizens of Monongalia County would drive to place sorted recyclables. In that they discussed it and made a suggestion that our commission meet at a work session with their commission and their solid waste authority. It may be a long-term solution in that we could possibly enable us to get out of the recycling business. So I would like to make a motion that we entertain their invitation and go to their commission with their solid waste authority and see if a plan can be made.
Okay, I'm trying to think of how I would respond. I am not wanting to do that at this time. I think we have a tremendous plan in place. We have the citizens now understanding, starting July 11th, the weekly program. I just got the results back. I was gonna wait till next week, but we did 32 tons of recycling during the last 2 months, and that's going every other week. My concern is that we finally have a routine, we have a program, we have a website, and we have a group of people that are working on this. And in talking and reviewing Marion County, they only have 1.5 people in who actually do the recycling. And my concern is if to go backwards and put these bins out there, then we have to have people in control, then we're going to have people picking it up. And in this way, we have a really neat system. And at this time, I mean, if we want to talk generally, in fact, one of my recommendations is to talk to Harrison and Marion County commissioners. There could be a number of issues. Now, if we want to discuss that issue, fine. But I There's a solid waste authority meeting tonight, but I'll be blunt. They've done nothing to work with this commission or the recycling group. They've been non-existent. We've not heard a thing from them. So I see them as just a figment of the state's imagination that is there. I would be adamantly opposed at this time for any sort of change. We just started developing this program, and I'd like to work with the year-long program that we have in place. I believe it's very successful, and I do not want to move forward in that area at this time. That's how I feel.
Well, I look at it as a step forward, not a step backward. I would like to see us get out of the recycling business in Monongalia County and work cooperatively and collaboratively with Marion County as we did on the lock system. That's my position. So,
well, my understanding of the motion
is
that we are setting down with Marion County Commission and Solid Waste Authority. No decisions are made. My concern, Tom, if it's restricted to that, because I have real problems spending any more money on this.
Oh, yes.
You know that. But one of the things we said back in January and February when we started this whole thing and put you in charge of the recycling was that we would explore further long-term plans with the Marion County and, as you said, Harrison County. And maybe that's what we need to do. If Ed would modify his motion to include Harrison County in that, Harrison County, Marion County, and Solid Waste Authority, all the way up and down the interstate, I think you wouldn't have an objection to that.
No, because that would be one of the topics then. I would look at it that way.
That
because
would be totally,
the other topics would be economic improvement. That's what we wanted to talk about.
That would be totally acceptable
okay.
to me.
I would be comfortable
okay.
with that.
I'll expand that to Marion, to Harrison
yes.
County.
Yes.
I will second that motion as amended.
Okay, it's been properly moved and seconded, and we will amended with Harrison County to discuss recycling and some other issues. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed. I think that's a little more, I'm a little more comfortable with that.
That's fine.
And then we could go from there. That's fine. Eldon?
As you already mentioned, the celebration of America, most people have left now. Is the sheriff still out there? The committee selected the sheriff as there's the sheriff. I assume they notified you that the committee selected the sheriff's department as the employer of the year.
Yes.
So
celebration of America committee.
Yes. So that's one way we get you down there, right?
That was nice. I think what they were looking for was free security.
and now. I'm not going to say anything.
Come on, give me some inside scoop.
No, it's totally a committee thing, and I think the sheriff's office was a good selection. And, I was going to select the commission, but I thought that was biased, so I didn't step the commission out of it.
The commission is kind of over everything.
Yeah. So
co-employers, as it were.
Right.
So everyone,
please come to the parade. The parade will be starting at 5:00, I think 5:30. 5:00. Okay, thank you. 5:00, and then there'll be ceremonies and fireworks afterwards. So we encourage everyone. All elected officials, sitting elected officials. Are welcome to set on the stage and will be introduced. So that's one thing. The other thing I want to bring up was interesting. I had it on my notes to bring it up, and the newspaper had an article on it. As a matter of fact, the lead article on it today, with this waterways rule that has come out. The NACO conference, as you know, that is in Charlotte, North Carolina. Next week, the end of next week, which I'm going to attend since it's so close. NACO and other county officials throughout the United States have been gravely concerned for over 2.5 years when EPA started to put this, what I call ditch ditch rule in effect. I it may be a little bit exaggeration. I think, Bobby, maybe you recall I discussed it with you a couple of years ago about the runoff there from where the recycling was. That was in discussion then as a really bad rule. The problem is not so much their goal, but the vagueness of the rule itself. The way it is written, I could interpret it.
I'm sorry.
And being a lawyer, you know I can interpret all kind of stuff. I could interpret it to mean that if Bobby was washing, or the motor pool was washing county vehicles, that runoff would have to be contained in a special containment area. And we would have to get an EPA permit to do that. Mm-hmm. And then they say, no, that will never happen. Baloney. That I read the rule the way it reads. And I commend our Attorney General and I commend Murray Energy for taking this to court. It's something that is of grave concern to the way local government and counties especially operate, because we operate right at the ground level. And the things we do that could be greatly affected. And I know Bob Doyle, his job, he could be filling out EPA permits on a constant basis. He might have to hire someone to do nothing but fill out the permits. This rule is way overextended, and I commend the newspaper for putting that above the fold there. That's an issue that really needs to be straightened out. It's not good enough to say, well, we'll never use it that way. Well, I read it that way. So I'm sure, that, matter of fact, that is a major thing on the NACO conference, and I will be attending. And I'm sure NACO will continue their opposition as they have over the last couple years. The other thing I was going to mention was that, and I don't know, Sheriff, I wanted to bring up again, you went down and spoke on the tax reform.
I did not. I wasn't able to go down there.
Oh, okay. I thought you were mentioning. Okay.
I was planning on it as part of the Sheriff's Association, but I think Tom McComas went.
Tom went. Okay. I've been trying to keep track of it and I'm gonna keep on top of it. I found your editorial in the paper today interesting. It's a good editorial. It reminded me of an old saying, is how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. And that's basically what the article said, and the way I interpreted the op-ed. Tax reform is a major issue, but we've got to be vigilant in protecting our revenues. We could drastically the food tax is a primary example of taking something away, and this was at state level, mm-hmm. taking something away and not replacing it.
Right.
And that's why the county or why the state is in such straits right now. Well, the things that are being propositioned out there, especially the personal inventory tax, and it's not a Democrat or Republican thing at all, because Nancy Cartmell testified that she has never, in all her years of being a county commissioner in Cabell County, had any business say I can't come to West Virginia because your personal inventory tax. It just doesn't happen. But that is something that they've talked about a lot, and if they take that away, it could crush a lot of counties. I'm just trying to give a report that we stay diligent on this tax reform, because it could really hurt all 55 counties if they make any changes and don't replace it. I believe in tax reform. I think there is some things that need to be reformed, but it just need to be cautiously. So I wanted to give that report. That is also an issue at the NACO conference that I will also be attending, seminar. So I'll be able to come back and give more information at that time. Thank you.
Thank you for your report. Three quick items. As I said, I was fortunate to get away and go to Vegas, and I was shocked when wearing my West Virginia shirt how many people came up, and when I said I was from Mon County, the positive remarks that were, they knew already, they said, oh, you're one of the top best small cities. I was shocked and real pleased that it wasn't negative, it was fact the exact opposite, wanted to know what we were doing, and on behalf of the three of us, I will keep saying that the county commission and the partnership, and they were really pleased of what Mon County and living, and they wanted to know, you know, what we were doing more to try and attract more people just to Mon County. So it was a real positive thing when we were down there. Second, thanks, Ed, because I did want to bring up about having, you brought Marion County, but I was hoping that we could also make it to Harrison County and talk about economic development. And also the other thing would be to try and combine, I would call it like a North Central group for when we go down to the legislature. I think what we need to do is combine all three. I think we're a unique situation, and
I think we should include Preston in that as well. That's
fine with me.
I think that's a good idea.
If that's all right.
Preston would be a good addition. Why?
Well, yeah,
right,
have the commissioners
right along the interstate.
Okay, yep. Then we'll just add that as. Okay, that's fine, because that's what I thought would be neat to get the count, and we would even offer if they wanted to come here or somewhere, but I wanted your approval, so that's good. Let's work on that. Okay, let's add Preston County to that. And finally, tomorrow, you all know that everyone's invited. We are having the naming of the bridge, the James Wickline Bridge, Thursday, which is tomorrow at 1 o'clock on the bridge at Osage. We have a film, Martin Vossen's here again from the Netherlands. He is... brought a film crew. They are filming. We were on the radio. They've been going to Elkins. They've been going all over the state. And they will be there tomorrow. We will have the naming. Then we will go over to the museum tomorrow. And then on Saturday, they will be filming the July 4th celebration. And everyone who will be there down at your celebration will be in this movie. And we have a special dedication to give to Martin and to the people who have sacrificed their lives, and what I said was the true meaning of why we're celebrating July 4th. So I'm real excited and honored to represent the three of you on this endeavor. Basically, that is it. Is there anything else before we move? Do I have a motion to move into executive session?
So moved.
Second.
Been properly moved and second. We'll move into, all those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
We'll move into executive session at this time, 11:05. Do I have a motion to come out of executive session?
So moved.
Second.
The proper move and second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay, we're out of executive session. We're back in regular session. Is there one other comment that we need to make publicly?
Yes. Due to some unforeseen circumstances and minimal delays, we need to consider moving the dedication date to a date non-specific right now. We'll take a look at it and see where we are in a week or two.
So July 30th will not be the date.
Correct.
At this time. Okay, so we're aware of that. Yeah. And we will send a memo out immediately to all office staff.
Yes.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
Proper moved and second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.